This is yours.
I don't.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Hey, so third talk of the morning is by Chan Ming is from Argus and Caltech. And Chan Ming brings us a cyclic bundle from non-convex.
Thank you. So first I want to thank organizers for inviting me here. It has been a very nice conference so far. Okay. So my title is cyclic Higgs bundles on non-compact surface. So I want to first emphasize that if we first have a Betti moduli space as the representations, so the correspondence to Doppler moduli space as a Higgs bundle, Higgs field. And then there is a Durand moduli space as a flat connection and also the related harmonic maps. And then all of these are homeomorphic to each other. And I want to emphasize this talk is about this direction. Even the title is about non-compact surface, I want to first review what's in the closed surface case. So part one is the closed surface case. Is let sigma be a closed Riemann surface? And we consider cyclic Higgs bundles. Over sigma as follows. So E is the direct sum of nine bundles. And with this condition as a determinant is a trivial bundle. And the Higgs field will be like gamma 1, gamma 2, to gamma n minus 1, and then gamma n. As an endomorphism from E to the E to the K, which is a holomorphic with respect to the corresponding holomorphic structure. And then we ask for the condition as all these gamma I are not zero sections. So by the work of Heating and Simpson, there is a unique Hermitian metric H on the vector bundle with the condition as determinant of H is 1 as a metric on the trivial bundle. Solving the heating equation. Which is the curvature of a chain connection plus the Higgs field and is dual with respect to this metric. So as in Andy's talk, he calls this H as a harmonic metric. And here this chain connection is uniquely determined by the holomorphic structure on E and this metric H. So using this equation, we can actually have equivalent condition as having a collection lambda as the direct as the summation of this chain collection plus Higgs field and its dual is a flat metric. So this equation actually means a lot. This part is a flat collection, can be seen as a representation. And here is the harmonic matrix connection, and here is a holomorphic object. Okay. And this gives us the representation as a holonomy from surface group into SLNC. And using this permission metric plus this flat connection rule, we can get a harmonic map, which is a rho equivalent. From the universal cover to the associated matching space for SLNC. So this picture means that solving heating equation gives one direction. Of the non-linear quantity theory, I use the same notation. Okay. And in particular, for this type of Higgs bundles, we have the fact by Bradley. Saying that for the cyclic Higgs bundle, the Hermitian metric solving heating equation is always diagonal, means H can be written as a diagonal of H1, H2, to Hn. And of course, again, we always require determinant equal to 1. And then the proof used the uniqueness of Hermitian metric solving the heating equation. Now, finally, we come to Riemann surface with punctures. So here we consider the surface, it's a Riemann surface structure coming from a closed Riemann surface minus finite many points. Okay. So as an example, is a complex plane is a C hat minus infinity. Has one puncture. So again, we consider the cyclic Higgs bundle over this Riemann surface with punctures. And ask the following questions. Firstly, can one find a diagonal metric H of unit determinant solving the heating equation? For this question, the answer is yes. So this is by the work of Simpson and also by Picard Boch. So depending on the pulse order of the Higgs field as a puncture. And secondly is such a diagonal metric H of unit determinant unique? So I want to say that this unit determinant is not really additional condition. Because if we don't require this, you can just scale it. So this is for to make sure this uniqueness makes sense. Okay. So the real uniqueness is about if we require diagonal, is it unique? So the answer is from literature, not really. So what's known for us? This is really by Simpson's original proof for the compact case, showing the uniqueness for Hermitian metric. And say any two mutually bounded solutions to Hitchin equation are differ by a constant scalar. Okay, so if we require determinant equal to 1, that really says if we require mutually, there are no two metrics are mutually bounded, and so this is the uniqueness under this mutually bounded condition. Okay. And I want to remind you, this is uniqueness statement is very similar to the Liouville theorem for bounded harmonic bounded holomorphic function, saying that any bounded holomorphic function on C has to be constant. But if we don't have this boundedness condition, there are a lot of holomorphic functions. Okay. It can be e to the z, z to the z, a lot. So really the uniqueness here is about having a control on the function's growth. What's missing in non-compact case for showing the uniqueness? So the answer is boundedness of the solution, which is given for free for the compact case. So that's why in the compact case, the uniqueness of solution is there. But for the non-compact case, this is really an issue because we lose this boundedness. And our focus in this talk is to answer question 2 about this uniqueness. So also I want to mention a motivation for people who concern more about the compact surface, and why do we need to care about non-compact surface? Is first a non-zero ray. As the T times the Higgs field over compact Riemann surface. The local behavior of the harmonic maps to the symmetric space. Becomes more and more like harmonic maps. I should say local behavior of harmonic maps. Near, for example, piece order 0 of this Qn, it will be more and more like a harmonic maps from C to the symmetric space. With Qn as z to the p dz. So there are a number of group people use this local model from this complex plane to symmetric space with this higher order zeros, which really becomes the pole, higher order pole at infinity. So for example, so Mazel, Swoboda, Weiss, and Witt, and Nora Frederiksen. And David Dumas, Mike Wolf, and Lofting, and Xinyi. To do degeneration is degeneration of Higgs bundles on compact Riemann surface sigma t. But here sigma t is also changing to Higgs bundle at sigma infinity, which is a Lodian surface. So this makes the not just C is interesting, but also surface with puncture is interesting. So there are people who are studying like this. So Lofting for SL3R case. And in Swoboda for SL2C case. Now we go to study the uniqueness for the baby case. As mentioned in Andy's talk too, the scalar equation on C. So this is for SL2R case. First, on the left-hand side is a Higgs bundle over C. So the E is case 1/2 and the case minus 1/2. So it's really all and all. Okay. And the Higgs field is 0, 0, 1, Q2. And if we ask for the Hermitian metric, which is diagonal as is W and is minus W, solving the heating equation. And this time it really becomes the equation as Laplacian of W equal to is 2W of Q2 square minus is minus 2W. So it's one scalar equation. And the corresponding picture in the harmonic map side is the harmonic map phi from complex plane to the symmetric space, but in the real part, which is really H2. So it's a satisfy additional condition as the holomorphic energy density non-vanishing. So we denote the function W satisfy S2W in the holomorphic energy density. And also define the Hopf differential Q2 as phi z and phi bar z. And the harmonicity of phi implies first that this Q2 is holomorphic. So which is really corresponding to here, we ask this Q2 is holomorphic. And also one more equation relating this holomorphic energy density and the Hopf differential exactly in the same equation. So this is a concrete picture of the correspondence between Higgs bundles over complex plane and the harmonic maps from complex plane to H2. Okay. So here, if given a data Q2 and then solving this heating equation, it actually gives us the geometry side is given the Hopf differential, finding a harmonic map with that Hopf differential. So the result by O and 1 is fix a holomorphic function Q on the complex plane. There exists a unique solution W to the equation. So I want to say that equation, okay? That e to the 2w dz square defines a complete metric. On the complex plane. So I want to remark that this Q is not just the polynomial, it can be any holomorphic function. We have this solution. So as the harmonic maps interpretation, as I'm saying for a given holomorphic function Q on the complex plane, there exists a unique harmonic map to H2 such that this one is the energy density, so we give a name phi, defines a complete metric on C. So this is with its Hopf differential Q dz square. So this is exactly solving the equation, giving the geometry. So now we give you first the theorem as suppose this Q is a holomorphic function on the complex plane with finite zeros. Then, if Q is a polynomial, there is a unique solution, W, to the equation. So this improves the uniqueness here by getting rid of this such that condition. If Q is a polynomial. And secondly, if not, means Q can be e to the z, z e to the z, this kind of case. There are at least two solutions. Okay. So just as this theorem, we can interpret this solution to the equation as the existence of harmonic maps. The unique for the polynomial case is unique, and for the non-polynomial case, not unique. Okay. And then the remark is, all these stories about SL2R case, but there is analog, there is a similar story for SL3R case. Especially also for the polynomial case, for this harmonic map, it goes to ideal polygon, and for SL3R case, it goes to polygon in RP2. And if we look at this theorem, we can see the uniqueness coming from this polynomial, which means its behavior at a puncture. So the Q's behavior at puncture determines the uniqueness. So here, if Q is a polynomial, this differential Q dz square has at least whole order 4 as infinity. It's about system case. So the theorem is for the cyclic Higgs bundle. Over Riemann surface with puncture sigma, where this EV as L1 to LN, again, we need this determinant is trivial. Suppose determinant of this Higgs field. So first is a holomorphic antidifferential. So we require this has a power order at least n at each puncture. Then there is a unique Hermitian metric. So we say diagonal Hermitian metric of unit determinant. So solving his equation. So for this case, it's no longer dealing with a scalar equation. It has to deal with a system. And the controlling system has its own difficulty. So using this uniqueness, we can immediately say, for example, in the case if phi has additional symmetry, and then it's isomorphic to its dual. So it has L1 to Ln, L inverse to L1 inverse. And the Higgs field also has the symmetry as gamma 1, gamma 2, until to the middle, but keep the same as before, gamma 2, gamma 1, and here gamma n. So it's a symmetry along this diagonal. So if we require diagonal solution, it has to be also respect this symmetry. So in our paper, we give two different approaches to this theorem. So first one is the PDE method. And second one is the classification of filtered Higgs bundles. Mainly, to say it only has one filtered Higgs bundle structure. But in this talk, I will focus on the first method because this is the one I'm more comfortable to present to you. And also give a remark. If you see the theorem, there is a condition as the pole order greater or equal to n. Why we need that condition? So this pole order greater or equal to n is to make sure that this n differential, so taking the power 2 over n, defines a complete singular metric on surface. Okay. So this is really why we require this pole order. So now we start to see the equation. For simplicity, we only work with the easiest case. For this talk is net the sigma as complex plane and the E as a fixed bundle, which is really all. Okay. And the Higgs field is 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, and the last is also 1. And the heating equation, so we look for not send for the AH. We require AH as H1, H2 to HN, and equal to EW1, EW2 to EWN. Okay. So the heating equation becomes the curvature of trunk connection plus the lip bracket of phi and phi studio. So it becomes this on C written as this W1 to Wn as the Laplacian of W1 equal to minus of Wn plus W1 minus of minus W1 plus W2. And W2 equal to 1 plus W2 minus W2 plus W3 until to the end. And the left-hand side is this part. Because with respect to holomorphic frame, this is just H inverse of DH, okay, which is the Laplacian of log H. Okay. And we move this part on the right-hand side. And we require determinant of H equal to 1, which means we require W1 plus W2 to Wn equal to 0. So what we want to show for this case as an example for the theorem. We know that 0, 0 to 0 is a solution. So our goal is to show that's the only solution. But because each equation is not an equation for a single function, it's related to the previous one itself and later. So maybe there are W1 goes to some girl, and then Wn matches that, we don't know. So it's hard to say that this is the only solution. So let's first get our tool, which is in the drawer, as this one. This is our main tool to deal with the complete manifold, which is the Chen-Yau maximal principle. So it tells us if we work with a complete manifold with rich curvature has a lower bound, how to say a function satisfying an equation is bounded from above is that if this C2 function, to make this Laplacian make sense, C2 function U satisfying the Laplacian on U is greater than the right-hand side as a function evaluate on U. And we ask this function is growing faster than this T to the P, where this p is greater than 1. So basically, why we need that to be 1, greater than 1, is we want the integration of t minus p is less than infinity. Okay, that's why the p greater than 1. So, but I also think this is a very loose condition because we don't require this f to be smooth, to be continuous. It's just a function. So we only care about its value. And if this condition satisfied, we have the conclusion U is bounded from above. Okay. So this is a very useful principle to tell us if given an equation, how do we see the bounded property. So let's see a baby case. So very, very baby case. Okay. So the baby case is we have one equation. So it's still on C. And the equation becomes Laplacian of W is equal to 2e to the W minus e to the minus 2W. If you remember, this is the harmonic map from C to H2 with the Hopf differential 1. Okay? So we want to show that W is bounded. And using this, we say it has to be the trivial solution 0. So how to use this one to show it's bounded? First, we see that on C, it's complete, it has a curvature 0. And then on the right-hand side, this Ft is e to the 2t minus e is minus 2t. It's much, much faster. How to say? Much, much faster than t squared. Okay? So in this way, we get W is bounded from above. And this equation is symmetrical to the minus W. You can do again. So W is bounded from above and below. So as we know, bounded from above and below, this means it's mutually bounded with zero solution. By the uniqueness, we know that W equal to 0 is the only solution. So this is the baby case. It's, of course, not the way to show the theorem. So for the system case, our problem is that we don't have a single equation for single function to directly apply this theorem, to apply this good principle, even though it's so helpful. So this is a surprise. I don't know how to explain to you how to find that one, but we do find one. So we denote a function f coming from all this wi as the summation of or the exponential of wi minus wj for every I less than j. Using this equation, we can rewrite an equation for this Laplacian of f. Okay. So we can do Laplacian of f and on each term. So the claim is this f satisfy. So there is a constant C0, C1, C2 greater than 0, and alpha greater than 1, such that Laplacian of f is greater than f to the alpha's power, so C0 minus C1 f plus C2. So here you can see why we need this key alpha greater than 1. Because then we can see this right-hand side grows at least as t to the alpha, where alpha is greater than 1. So apply the chain rule maximum principle. We obtain that f is bounded from above. And this tells us, because F really captures the difference between Wi minus Wj. So this tells us W1 is up to a constant is less than W2 to W3 until to the end. So there is still a direction missing. We hope to get Wn less than W1. And in this way, we use the sum equal to zero to know that every term is bounded. But how to get the other direction? So note the system of equation has a Zn symmetry. If you look at this equation system, there is no special position as W1 being the first equation. You can really start the second one and continue to move this one to the next and apply this again. So we can get to omega n is less than omega 1 and continue to the rest. So in this way, we get to all this Wi is bounded because of the sum equal to 0. So then we know that every two mutually bounded solution has to be the same. So that's why for this equation, system on C, you guess the solution is 0, 0, 0, and it's the only one. There is nothing else. Even though it seems at the beginning there is no control on the boundary behavior, and now it has to be going to 0. And in general, if we have a Qn being here, of course we don't have a trivial solution to start with, saying the trivial solution is the solution. But we can guess asymptotically trivial solution and show that the solution has to be bounded from that one. So the general case is a perturbation of this proof. So I stop here. Yeah, how do I get to this alpha first is equal to 2th n minus 1 of n minus 1 minus 1. Okay. So it's so it explains a little bit. Okay. So this is really using that when I do this Laplacian for this term, if I do for each term is omega I minus omega j. First is greater than is omega I omega j times of Laplacian to this one. So I'm using this one. So how to say the. So maybe I should say what's the style. The style is using this way. I have a family of function, small fi as ui minus ui plus 1. Okay. And then when I do this compilation, it's really on the left hand side is this one, but on the right hand side is lots of compilation of this fi's summation and products. So I use that. I have F0 square plus F0 inverse F1, F2 to Fn plus F1 inverse F2 to Fn and F2 inverse F3 to Fn and start from the F3 f n minus 1 f inverse. To get on the right-hand side, to get a term as f3 to fn minus 1 some power. Do you see the key? But because I always have a square there, so I always get something bigger than 1. So because all such terms from fi to fi plus k contributes one term in this f. So I have to, on the right-hand side, I have to really get this f out, not just a single term in the sum. So that's really the key. Which one?
If you q have zero, it's probably like at some point f t is always zero for any t. You see where this happens?
So the thing is, you see this condition is not about some t, it's about t going to infinity. So how to deal with the inside and to the infinity? You put this f when it's being as the compact part of the surface, it's just a constant, as small as possible to make this to be true. And when it goes to the packager case, you just use this one. That's where I comment that f is not necessary to be a continuous function. So the zeros doesn't matter because it's inside the surface. The Qn has poles at the puncture. So you can always cut a compact surface to avoid zeros. Yeah.
So when you have the function of 1, you don't have the Cn symmetry
of
the equation, is that right?
Yes, but I view that when I get rid of the trivial solution, all these terms, when I minus all this omega n as Qn's different power, and I obtain a new solution. So this will become like a Tn square, T1 square, T1 square, T2 square, Tn square, plus a term K1, K2, to Kn. Where these Ki's have some value inside, but when it goes to neighbors of packagers, it's zero. And this Ti's have the behavior as being inside, it has some value. Can be zero, can be something. But when it goes to the packager case, neighborhood is one. And then I will change here to be outside K. That's a case for Qn. So the claim is outside K is satisfied this. But then I can apply this theorem again. Does that?